You're listening to the audio production of Four Portraits, One Jesus, a survey of Jesus in the Gospels, second edition, by Mark L. Strauss, published by Zondervan and read by Christopher Ragland. Please note that you may download an accompanying PDF that provides enhanced materials for this audiobook. To download the PDF, please visit harperchristianaudio.com. Introduction. Congratulations. You are about to embark on a study of the most important person in human history. To Christian believers, the Gospels record the greatest story ever told, the events of the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus the Messiah. They narrate the climax and turning point of human history, when God acted decisively to achieve salvation for people everywhere. To study the Gospels is to study the foundation of Christianity. Even to those who do not follow Jesus as their Lord, the Gospels serve as the primary source documents for information about the most influential life ever lived. Jesus of Nazareth has been the topic of more books, movies, discussions, and debates than any person in history. Even our calendar is dated from the beginning of this man's life. Millions have dedicated their lives to serving him. Countless thousands have died as martyrs for his cause. Great good has been done in his name, from feeding the poor to educating children to providing medical aid and developmental assistance for impoverished nations. Great evil has also been done, from crusades of conquest to the slaughter of innocent people to the torture of those labeled heretics. But who was this man Jesus, and how did his movement begin? In this textbook, we will examine the nature and content of the four Gospels, the primary source documents on the life and ministry of Jesus of Nazareth. Where did these books come from? What was their purpose? What can they tell us about Jesus? These are the questions we will seek to answer. This book is an introductory survey. Part 1, chapters 1 to 3, provides information concerning the nature of the Gospels and methods that have been developed for their study. Part 2, chapters 4 to 6, is concerned with the historical, religious, and cultural background of the Gospels, their first century setting. Part 3, chapters 7 to 10, is a study of the four Gospels as narrative literature, their content, themes, and theology. Finally, Part 4, chapters 11 to 20, turns to the question of the historical Jesus, examining the Jesus quests of the last three centuries, the historical reliability of the Gospels, and the life and teachings of Jesus of Nazareth. This second edition of the text includes an expanded and updated bibliography, found in the accompanying PDF, the introduction of new theories, such as the Ferrer hypothesis to the synoptic problem, new methods, such as performance criticism, a new section on geography, and expanded discussion on various topics. Bibliographies that go with each chapter, found in the accompanying PDF, direct the student to resources for further study. No one approaches history as an unbiased observer, and it would be naive to assume that this textbook could be written without presuppositions or a point of view. It is appropriate, therefore, to state my own. My goal is to produce a text that is both methodologically critical and confessionally evangelical, in the traditional, non-political sense of that term. The text is critical in that it seeks to utilize the best literary and historical tools and resources available today. I have also tried to present the data in a fair and balanced manner, without glossing over problems or selectively manipulating results. The text is evangelical in that it is written from the perspective of one who confesses Jesus as Lord, and who believes that these Gospels are not merely human documents, but the inspired and authoritative Word of God. While I will seek not to let these assumptions bias a critical analysis, it is unnecessary and even inappropriate to deny them. Indeed, adopting the same evangelical mindset of the evangelists, the gospel writers, will allow us to enter their world more fully and to hear the gospel story as it was intended to be heard, as the good news of salvation achieved through the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus the Messiah. In the first edition of this text, I expressed my gratitude to those who read parts or all of my drafts and offered many insights and suggestions, especially scholars Frank Thielman, Gary Burge, Janine Brown, and Donald Versiput, and students Marcy Ford, Bill Zettinger, Janice Raymond, and Mike Anderson. I remain grateful to these friends, as well as those at Zondervan, who labored with me to bring the work to fruition, especially Stan Gundry, who first approached me about its writing, Jack Kuhatchek, Katya Coverett, Brian Phipps, and for this second edition, Laura Weller and Dale Williams. My gratitude now extends to all those over the past decade who have used the text for their own study and for courses they have taught or attended. I am most grateful for the encouragement I have received, as well as the many helpful suggestions. Part 1. Introduction to the Four Gospels. Chapter 1. What are the Gospels? Objectives. After reading this chapter, you should be able to do the following. Describe the genre of the Gospels as history, narrative, and theology. Suggest some reasons why there are four Gospels. Explain what it means to read vertically and horizontally through the Gospels. Discuss the benefits and potential liabilities of harmonizing the Gospels. Four Gospels, One Jesus. When my oldest son was 2 years old, we took him to a portrait studio to have his picture taken. Two-year-olds are a bundle of emotions, and getting them to sit still through a photo shoot is a real challenge. During that short session, my son went through a range of moods, from contentment to laughter to pouting to anger to tears. I remember looking through the proofs afterward. The first showed him serenely content, smiling at the camera. In the second, he was laughing delightedly as the photographer waved a stuffed animal in his face. In the next, he was beginning to get bored and had put on a cute little pout. The fourth showed him downright angry, with a defiant, "just try to make me smile" look on his face. By the last shot, he had dissolved into tears. The poor little guy had had enough. Which of these pictures captured my son's personality? The answer, of course, is all of them. Each one caught a different side of his multifaceted personality. Together, they gave us an insightful glimpse into who he is. This little story is a good analogy for the New Testament Gospels. Each of the four Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, paints a unique portrait of Jesus Christ. Each provides special insight into who he is and what he accomplished. The Gospels exhibit both unity and diversity, bearing witness to the same Jesus, unity, but viewing him from unique perspectives, diversity. What are these four unique portraits? At the risk of oversimplifying, we may say that Matthew presents Jesus as the Jewish Messiah, the fulfillment of Old Testament hopes. Mark portrays him as the suffering Son of God who offers himself as a sacrifice for sins. Luke's Jesus is the Savior for all people who brings salvation to all nations and people groups. And in John, Jesus is the eternal Son of God, the self-revelation of God the Father who came to bring eternal life to all who believe. These are not contradictory portraits, but complementary ones. Having four Gospels gives us a deeper, more profound understanding of Christology, the nature of Jesus' person and work. Not only are the Gospels unique in their portraits of Jesus, They are also unique in their presentations. Mark is the most dramatic of the four, a powerful and fast-moving story that grips the reader from beginning to end. Matthew is the most structured of the Gospels, crafted around five carefully ordered teaching sections. Luke is the most thematic, with themes like God's love for the lost, the role of the Spirit, and Jerusalem's role in God's plan resurfacing again and again. John's is the most theological of the four, with more explicit statements concerning Jesus' identity and purpose. I should add that all of the Gospels are all of these things, dramatic, structured, thematic, and theological, but they have important differences in emphasis. The Synoptic Gospels and the Gospel of John. The Gospels also display degrees of diversity. The first three, Matthew, Mark, and Luke, are known as the Synoptic Gospels, from the Greek synopsis, meaning viewed together, because they view the life and ministry of Jesus from a similar perspective, follow the same general outline, and record a great deal of common material. The Gospel of John presents a strikingly different perspective. The author of the fourth Gospel omits most of the material found in the Synoptics and includes much unique material. John also writes with a different style and dwells more on the theological significance of Jesus' words and deeds. Scholars debate whether the author knew the Synoptic Gospels and supplemented them or was writing independently of them. I will discuss this issue in more detail in my introduction to the fourth Gospel. The Gospel Genre. The first question readers must ask when approaching any literature is, what am I reading? This is the question of genre, or type of literature. If I pick up a newspaper and read, "The President Prepares to Address Congress," I recognize this as a news report and expect to read factual information. On the other hand, if I pick up a book and read, "Once Upon a Time, There Were Three Bears," I know I am reading a fairy tale. I'm not concerned about whether these bears actually existed, what country they were from, or whether they were grizzlies or brown bears. I read to be entertained and perhaps to look for moral lessons. In cases like these, we identify genre easily. But identification is not always so easy, and it is possible to misidentify literary genres. One person standing in a grocery store checkout line may read the National Enquirer headline, "Aliens Invade Los Angeles," and fear that they are in mortal danger. Another identifies the genre as entertainment tabloid and chuckles. Identifying genre is essential for both interpretation and application. To understand the Gospels, we must first ask, what are we reading? What kind of documents are these, and what sort of information are they meant to convey? Are they historical accounts meant to pass on factual information, or are they theological documents meant to teach spiritual truths? Or are they both? The identification of genre enables us to answer these questions. The genre of the Gospels may be described under three headings: history, narrative, and theology. The background to the term gospel. The English term gospel comes from the Old English Godspell, a translation of the Greek noun euangelion, meaning good tidings or good news. Euangelion was used in the Greek world for the announcement of good news, such as victory in battle or for the enthronement of a Roman ruler. An inscription for the birthday of the Roman Emperor Augustus, extolling the establishment of his kingdom, reads, "Good news, euangelia, to the world." In the Old Testament, the announcement of God's end-time deliverance of his people is sometimes referred to as good news. Isaiah chapter 52, verse 7 reads, "How beautiful on the mountains are the feet of those who bring good news, who proclaim salvation, who say to Zion, 'Your God reigns.' Isaiah chapter 40 verse 9, chapter 61 verse 1.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.